Expels ye heathen from the city that dreams. Ring them bells from the sanctuaries, cross the valleys and streams. For they're deep and they're wide, and the world's on its side. And time is running backwards, and so is the bride. Ring them bells, St. Peter, where the four winds blow. Ring them bells with an iron hand so the people will know. Oh, it's rush hour now, on the wheel and the plow. And the sun is going down upon the sacred cow. Ring them bells, sweet Martha, for the poor man's son. Ring them bells so the world will know that God is one. Oh, the shepherd is asleep where the willows weep, and the mountains are filled with lost sheep. Ring them bells for the blind and the deaf. Ring them bells for all of us who are left. Ring them bells for the chosen few, who will judge the many when the game is through. Ring them bells for the time that flies, for the child that cries when innocence dies. Ring them bells, St. Catherine, from the top of the room. Ring them bells from the fortress for the lilies that bloom. Oh, the lines are long, and the fighting is strong, and they're breaking down the distance between right and wrong.
Good morning, and welcome to worship on this, the second Sunday after Christmas in this new year of 2022. We're gathered here apart but together at First United Presbyterian Church of Troy due to the expanding coronavirus numbers again. With COVID being so rampant in this area, we've decided to go to online worship only. So I welcome you from your homes. Welcome here. Welcome home. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Would you join with me in the gathering words? Let us worship the triune God.
Let us worship the one who spoke in the beginning and created something out of nothing.
Let us worship the triune God.
Let us worship the one who took on the clothing of humanity to set those who were oppressed free.
Let us worship the triune God.
Let us worship the one whose spirit rests continually upon us, calling us from sorrow-filled endings to bright new beginnings.
Let us pray. The beginning of the year is upon us, and today we gather to offer the strides as well as the struggles of this past year to God. We gather to give to the Creator both our hopes and our fears as we gather to worship our God. Holy Spirit, fill our hearts and our lives today as we worship. Grant us each the strength to sing our song, to pray our prayer, and to listen for the word that will drive our fears away and move us to offer praise and thanksgiving Inspire us today, we pray. Amen. Announcements to share with you this morning. Next Sunday, we will have part three of our adult faith ed discussion on Christian extremism. So we've talked about the history of Christian extremists, the contributing factors to what makes folks like that today. We've discussed the current thought processes. And now we'd like to discuss, where do we go from here? If we can't change the minds of those who think so differently from us, then how do we respond to it? And I'll give you a little spoiler alert. There is not an easy answer. So if you're looking for an easy answer, you're probably not going to find it. next Sunday, but if you're looking for a good discussion and a place to start, please join us next Sunday during our coffee fellowship time. Our coffee chat is via Zoom, and that link is found in the e-news. So if you don't receive our e-newsletter, go to unitedprestroy.org and sign up for it, and you'll get that link, and you can join us for that discussion next week. And looking further down the road, January 30th is the last Sunday of this month. It's also a fifth Sunday. And so just as we did something a little bit different for our fifth Sunday service in October, we're going to be doing something a little different for this fifth Sunday in January. And we're going to be having a hymn sing. Now, I know what you're asking yourselves. How are we going to have a hymn sing when we don't have anyone gathering together, or we might not still be back together when we don't have a live musician? We're going to do it this way. We're going to ask that if you've got a favorite hymn, if you've got something you'd like to sing, send an email, give a call to Judy or myself or to the church office, and let us know what you'd like to sing. And hopefully we'll be able to put as many of those requests together as we can and create a fun, enjoyable worship service with many of the hymns that you like to sing. And we'll do that for the 30th of January. So if you know of one you'd like to sing, let us know one way or the other by January 16th. So you've got a couple weeks to think about that and let us know. At this time, we will have this morning's scripture readings.
A reading from Samuel, chapter 2, verses 18 to 20 and 26. Samuel, on the other hand, would minister before Yahweh, wearing a linen ephod around his waist. Each year, Samuel's mother would bring him a small cloak when she went up to sacrifice with Elkanah. Eli would bless Elkanah and Hannah and say, "May God grant you children by Hannah in place of the one you gave to God." Then they would return to their home. As young Samuel grew up, he increasingly grew in stature and in favor with God and the people. And reading from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 to 17. Because you are God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with heartfelt compassion, with kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with one another, forgive whatever grievances you have against one another, forgive in the same way God has forgiven you. Above all else, put on love, which binds the rest together and makes them perfect. Let Christ's peace reign in your hearts, since as members of one body, you have been called to that peace. Dedicate yourselves to thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, rich as it is, dwell in you. Instruct and admonish one another wisely. Sing gratefully to God from your hearts in psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit. And whatever you do, whether in speech or in action, do it in the name of Jesus our Savior, giving thanks to God through Christ.
Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Speak to us today, O God, not what I would have to say, but what you would have each of us to hear. Amen. So when I'm in class, or at least when I used to be in class, or when I would go to a lecture or that kind of thing, I like to sit toward the back of the room. And I know that in churches, that's not an unusual thing. A lot of folks like to sit in the back. Although in the classroom situations, at least, there's a certain stereotype that the better students always sit up front and it's just like the riffraff that's in the back. I assure you that's not why I sit back there. I like to sit toward the back so that if and when there's a discussion happening, I can see everyone who's taking part in the discussion and contributing to that conversation. So one year in college, I was sitting as usual toward the back of the classroom in my New Testament class. And true to that stereotype, there was a very smart young first-year student sitting right up front. And it seemed like his hand was perpetually raised in the air. And he had an answer to almost every single question that the professor posed, as well as a challenge to much of how she interpreted the Bible. And it wasn't long before I began to notice a pattern emerging to this young man's comments. Nearly every answer or disagreement began with, "Well, my pastor says," or, "Well, I always was taught that." And one day, the professor, clearly exasperated by this repetition, snapped, "I know that's what your pastor thinks, but what do you think? What do you think about this? What do you believe?" When I talked to her outside of the class later, my professor confided in me that she never had a problem with students disagreeing with her in class. In fact, she encouraged that. But she hated trying to teach a class where her students were so closed off to even learning about another point of view. Now, in today's scriptures, we heard about Samuel as an apprentice to the temple priests. And even as a young boy, Samuel was already performing duties and learning skills that he needed when he, too, would become a priest. And the scripture states that as young Samuel grew up, he increasingly grew in stature and in favor with God and the people. He grew in wisdom every day. And last week in our scriptures reading, we heard the story of Jesus being left behind in Jerusalem. At 12 years old, Jesus had slipped away from his parents, and it took them a couple days, but eventually they found him, as Luke states, in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Now, when writing his gospel, Luke didn't include the story of Jesus being left behind in Jerusalem to show what lousy parents Jesus had. He recorded this story to show the importance of this education that Jesus was seeking. And Luke concluded that passage with a reference to the passage that we just read from the book of Samuel. "And Jesus grew in wisdom, in years, and in favor with God and people alike." Both Samuel and Jesus, in preparation for lives of service and teaching, took seriously their need to learn from their elders, to learn from others, in order to increase their wisdom. Now, in writing to the Colossian church, Paul told the people to clothe themselves, he said, with heartfelt compassion, with kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. He also told them, "Let the word of Christ, rich as it is, dwell within you. Instruct and admonish one another wisely." Now, this was not meant to be some sort of passive role. We don't have other people dress us, right? We do that ourselves. We choose and put our clothes on ourselves, and we're instructed to dress ourselves with compassion, with kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, and most of all, with love. Now, how do we do this? Paul says that we should let the word of Christ dwell within us. We need to learn the scriptures and grow in wisdom in order to prepare ourselves for lives of teaching and service. Paul says we're all part of the same body and that each of us should teach and admonish one another in wisdom. That takes preparation so that we can grow in wisdom. See, Samuel's mother gave him to the priests so that Samuel would grow up in the temple, that Samuel would grow up around the priests, learning from day one how to be a priest. Jesus deliberately, even at 12 years old, deliberately sought out the teachers in the temple so that he too could learn and grow in wisdom. I went to college for 4 years and then spent another 4 years in seminary. And then I served as a student pastor at a teaching church for 3 years. And then I was able to seek out and be called to a full-time pastorate. But you know, wisdom isn't just for pastors and teachers. Each of us is called to live as an example to the world. There are people in our own neighborhoods who will never set foot inside a church, who will never listen to a sermon, who will never turn on our YouTube channel and listen to what I have to say. You might be the only chance that they get to experience the word of Christ. You, not me, you might be the only chance. Have you clothed yourselves with compassion, with kindness, with humility, with gentleness, with patience? Have you clothed yourself with love? Does the word of Christ dwell within you? In this time of New Year's resolutions, I would challenge each one of you to learn and grow in wisdom. Resolve to read your Bible regularly. Come to an adult faith ed discussion. Read a devotional book. Listen to a podcast. Don't rely on me or anyone else to tell you what to believe. Because when someone asks you about your faith, they don't want to hear, well, my pastor says. They'll want to hear about your faith, about your understanding. What do you believe? See, the world is hungry for God's love. It really is. The world is hungry for God's love, and it is all of our responsibility to bring God's love to the world. They're not coming here for it, so we have to take it to them. We need to share it with them. Samuel and Jesus and Paul knew that in order to serve, they must learn first about their faith and practice sharing it. And we have to do the same. Resolve this year to grow in Christian knowledge and wisdom. Make the word of Christ dwell within you, and then go and share God's love, building up wisdom in others. And we never know when we're going to be in a situation to share the good news. And you know what? When you are in that situation, it is so much easier to share when you have that knowledge already inside you. These shouldn't be memorized things that we have to just kind of list off. It should be evident in how you live your life. how you show love to others, how you seek justice for the world. That is sharing the good news. And when you have that inside of you, it is so much easier for others to see it. And some things you do need to learn. We're all still in the process of learning. There is always going to be something new for us to learn. But there are many things that you already know. Think about the good news that you've experienced in your life. Think about that. What are the stories that you can share with others that show how God has worked in your life? What are those stories that you can share? Start with what you know. Start with what you know of God's love, and then share that love with others. It's January 2nd. A new year stretches out before us. Make this a new kind of New Year's resolution. Think about that love and share that love with others. Amen.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dead, said he. Lead you all wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance and they would not follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came with me and the dance went on. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I'll lead you all wherever you may be. And I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath and I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They went. Then they stripped and they hung me high and left me there on a cross to die. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I'll lead you all wherever you may be. And I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone. But I am the dance and I still go on. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I'll lead you all wherever you may be. And I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. They cut me down and I leapt up high. I am a life that will never, never die. I'll live in you if you live in me. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I'll lead you all wherever you may be. And I'll lead you all in the dance, said he.
If you have prayer requests, things to pray for, joys to share with others, concerns that you'd like others to know about, concerns you'd like us all to pray for, please share those. You can email me or email info@unitedpresstroy.org, or you can put them in the chat window in Facebook, and we will pray for them during the week. I do have two prayers that were sent to me this week. One is from Lisa H., who asks prayers for my good friend's father, Donnie. So our prayers are with Donnie and with Lisa's friend. And I would also ask that you please keep my friend Jamie in your prayers. She was unknowingly exposed to COVID at Christmas and has since tested positive and is experiencing minor, mild symptoms, but was around other family before she knew that she had been exposed. So we're not sure how far reaching this spread might be. So prayers for Jamie and for her family. At this time, I invite you to share those prayers, say them out loud, hold them in the quiet of your hearts. Either way, God knows, and we trust that God does care, God does hear, and God will respond. Let us pray. Gracious God, the last 2 years have been filled with sickness, with death, with job loss, isolation, anxiety, fear, and division. We are weary. In our weariness, we confess our cynicism and our skepticism, and we ask for your blessings. Make our new year a happy one, not by shielding us from sorrow and pain, but by strengthening us to bear it if it comes. Not by making our paths easy, but by making us sturdy enough to tread any path. Not by taking away our hardships, but by giving us the courage to face those adversities. Not by granting us unbroken sunshine, but by keeping our faces bright even in the shadows. Not by making our lives constantly pleasant, but by showing us where we are needed. O God, bless our hands to serve you more faithfully in this year to come. Guide our feet to walk in Christ's steps, imitating the example that he set for us during his time on earth, and empower us by your Spirit to love one another in consistent and creative ways. Amen. This is Christ's table. And there is nothing you need to do to come to Christ's table. You are seen. Where you are seen just as you are. You are cared about just as you are. And you are loved just as you are for who you are. You are loved. No matter your background or where you are on life's path, no matter what you may have done or left undone in your life, you are seen, you are cared about, God loves you unconditionally, and you are always welcome at Christ's table. Will this new year be a time of new life? New ways for us, or will we continue to live in the same old way? I invite us now to confess to God our failures as well as our hopes as we begin this new year. Please join with me in the prayer of confession. We admit that we always find the time to fill our stomachs, God, of every moment, but not our souls. We spend hours watching television, but not the wonders of your creation. We arrange outings with our friends, yet ignore your invitation to sit and talk. We make resolutions to change every aspect of our lives, except for that which pertains to you. Forgive us, God of glory, and make us new. In the moments to come this year, remind us that there is a time for everything. Then we do have those moments for grace, for hope, for joy, for a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's over. The last year is gone. Our words, our thoughts, our deeds are in the past. Now we begin anew. Today and every day, God offers us life and hope. Here, now, forever, we are forgiven and healed. This year, let us live as such people. Thanks be to God. Amen. May the God of new beginnings be with you.
And also with you.
People of God, lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the one who makes all things, including us, new.
Children of God, sing praises to the one who gives you new life.
We praise the one who continues to surprise us with hope and grace.
Before there was time, hope of eternity. You took a moment to bring creation out of chaos. You took time to create mountains and carve deep canyons. You made the time to fill the oceans and to plant food for all creatures. You found the time to plow rivers, to water a garden, and to shape us in your image. But we did not have time for you, preferring to spend our days chasing sin and our nights seeking death. You always made time for us, speaking of your hopes through the prophets, sharing your dreams through the angels. Then one day you decided to do a new thing, becoming one of us as Jesus became human to bring hope and grace to us. We give you thanks for Jesus, who is with us in every season of life. He comes not to judge us, but to forgive us. He comes not to cast us out, but to gather us into the new Jerusalem. He comes not to watch us suffer, but to confound the powers of evil and death, that we might live with you. In these sacred moments, send your Spirit to sanctify the bread and the cup, and to open the hearts of those who approach the table. As the bread of life touches our lips, may we be strengthened to serve those whom the world has forgotten. As the cup of salvation quenches our thirst for you, may we be enabled to bring relief to those who wander the desert wastes of our society. And when all time ends and all people are gathered around your table in heaven, we will rejoice in your presence and sing your praises forever, just as we now pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. when he knew that his time on earth was growing short. Jesus gathered in an upper room with his friends and disciples, and there they shared a Last Supper together. During that meal, Jesus took what was already on the table, bread and a cup of wine, and he shared it with them. First, he took the bread and gave thanks for it, and then he broke it and he passed it around to each of them, saying, "This bread is broken as my body soon will be broken." And he told them to take and eat of this. And after the supper was over, he took that cup and he passed it around the table and he told them, "This is the cup of a new kind of covenant, one poured out for the forgiveness of sins, one poured out for new life for all." And he told them, "Whenever you gather together for a meal, share bread and wine. Tell my story and remember me." Gracious and loving God, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine, and bless us also as we share them. By these gifts, unite us with Christ, with one another, and with all who eat at this table. Satisfy and satiate us with the knowledge of your unconditional and unfailing love. Amen. As we are all spread here and there, as our table is ever wider, I invite you to take whatever elements you have on hand, for it is not what we eat and drink together, but the act of eating and drinking together, the act of telling this story, the act of remembering that unites us one with each other and one with Christ. So I invite you to take the bread or whatever you have and share with one another. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Amen. And this is the cup of a new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of all of our sins, poured out for the new life that awaits all of us. Take and drink. Amen. Let us pray together. Or would you pray with me the prayer after communion? Blessed are you, O God, for you have visited and redeemed your people, coming to us in Jesus, delivering us from all enemies, remembering your holy covenant, the oath you swore to our ancestors in the faith. You have come to set us free that we may serve you without fear all the days of our lives. In Christ, you have given us knowledge of salvation and forgiveness of sins. You have come to give us light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. Therefore, we praise you with psalms and hymns and carols and with thankfulness in our hearts for your gift of yourself in Jesus. Through your Spirit, may we put on compassion, kindness, humility, and patience to understand and forgive one another. Bind us together in the perfect harmony of love. May the peace of Christ rule in our hearts that we may be instruments of your peace on earth. Amen.
Stretch the spangled heavens, infinite in time and place, flung the suns in burning radiance through the silent fields of space. We, your children, in your likeness, share inventive powers with you. Still creating, show us what we yet may do. Proudly rise our modern cities, stately buildings row on row, let their windows blank on feeling, stare on canyon streets below. Where the lonely drift unnoticed in the city's ebb and flow, lost to purpose and to meaning, scarcely caring where they go. We have ventured worlds undreamed of since the childhood of our race, on the ecstasy of winging through untraveled realms of space. Probe the secrets of the atom, yielding unimagined power, facing us with life's destruction, our most triumphant hour. As each far horizon beckons, may it challenge us anew. Children of creative purpose, serving others, honoring you. May our dreams prove rich with promise, each endeavor well begun. Great Creator, give us guidance till our goals and yours are one.
And And now, my friends, let us go forth into this new year in hope, seeking God's wisdom, seeking to share the love of God with others. Go now with the blessing of the Creator and of Christ and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Dance, lane, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he.